a bigot, Timmy. He gets burned. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So would you agree that whatever Christ's purpose was is the same purpose we have today?
Yes.
Is his work finished? Is the new heaven and the new earth revealed? And I would say his work is not yet finished. Isaiah 42, the mission of God's servant. Behold my servant whom I uphold, my elect in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice and right and reveal truth to the nations. He will not cry or shout aloud or cause his voice to be heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not quench. He will bring forth justice and truth. He will not fail or become weak or be crushed and discouraged till he has established justice in the earth. And the islands and the coastal regions shall wait hopefully for him and expect his direction and law. Thus says God the Lord, he who created the heavens and stretched them forth, he who spread abroad the earth and that which comes out of it, he who gives breath to the people on it and spirit to those who walk in it. I, the Lord, have called you for a righteous purpose and in righteousness. I will take you by the hand and I will keep you. I will give you for a covenant to the people and for a light to the nations, to open the eyes of the blind, to bring out prisoners from the dungeon and those who sit in darkness from prison. I am the Lord, that is my name. And my glory I will not give to another, nor my praise to graven images. Behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. And in Luke chapter 4, just after Jesus is tempted, he goes to the temple, and they bring him one of the books to read for the daily reading. It's no coincidence he was there on that day. And he found the place where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister, and he sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say in them, this day the scripture fulfilled in your ears. I say to you, this day that scripture is fulfilled in your ears.
Yes.
In Romans chapter 8, for even the whole creation, all of nature waits expectantly and longs earnestly for God's sons to be made known, waits for the revealing, the disclosing of their sonship. For the creation, all of nature was subjected to frailty, to futility, condemned to frustration, not because of some intentional fault on its part, but by the will of him who so subjected it, yet with the hope that nature, creation itself, will be set free from its bondage to decay and corruption and gain an entrance into the glorious freedom of God's children. We know that the whole creation of irrational creatures has been moaning together in the pains of labor until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves too, who have and enjoy the first fruits of the Holy Spirit, a foretaste of the blissful things to come. We groan inwardly, and we wait for the redemption of our bodies from sensuality in the grave, which will reveal our adoption, our manifestation as the sons of God. For in this hope we were saved. If we don't rise, if we won't shed light in the darkness, if we won't set the captives free, all of creation is cursed. It's cursed until we reveal the glory of the Lord in his shine, his glory, his light shines so brightly. that his glory fills the earth. The manifestation of the sons of God. I have prayed for manifestation. I have prayed and prayed. And I struggle. I don't want to make it an idol. I read something that said, if you lose something and you're devastated, it's idolatry. If we lose something, it's okay to be upset. But if we're devastated, mm-hmm. that thing held too high of a place, right. It's not the manifestation. It's who is being manifested. Mm-hmm. You know, Mike and I were just talking before the service that, you know, Friday we're going to focus on the rest. And when we start talking about rest, the first thing that came is that song, and I just forgot the song. Huh? No, the praise. Can't stop praising his name.
Yeah.
That shakes this place. Right. But that is one of the most restful songs that we sing because it's a high praise.
Yeah.
A high praise that takes us so far out of our own minds,
right.
So far out of our own circumstances, so far out of our own junk, that things can manifest.
Right.
In those high praises, there is rest in high praise. There is rest in the worshipful intimacy of those quiet moments. There is rest and peace that comes when we see those things take place that we've been promised. But we need to find rest when they don't come to pass, when we don't see them yet, because we know they will. We don't know when, we don't know the hour, but we know they will because he has promised. And we know that this world cannot be renewed. Our mortal bodies cannot be renewed until all these things come to pass.
Amen.
And hopefully, expectantly wait.
Yes.
Joyfully, peacefully.
Yes.
I don't know many people that peacefully and joyfully wait.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
No.
I am not naturally a patient person. But fruit of the Spirit,
sure.
The fruit of his Spirit in me, the result that I can just sit back and feast on,
uh-huh.
Patience. We all have heard, don't pray for patience. Trials bring patience.
Yeah.
This world is a trial.
It is.
This world is a trial. I don't want to say fed up, but maybe it's the hunger Mike's talking about. Maybe it's that hunger that I'm done. I'm done playing church. I'm done playing it's okay, I'm done playing I'm okay. It's not about me, it's not about our church, it's not about anything, it's about who we are manifesting.
Yes.
His purpose, his mission is our purpose and our mission because we are hidden in him.
Amen.
And
Amen.
It's just a reminder to look. Don't be afraid of the darkness, light up the darkness.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid when things don't come to pass. We pray and we speak God's word anyway, and we believe with all of our heart.
Yeah.
You know, we lost Joni this week. I prayed and I saw her receive a new heart. It didn't happen in the natural world, but she has a new heart right now.
Yes.
She is whole. She is pain-free, and I would have rather she rose up in this natural body and walked and jumped and danced, but she is dancing now. And as much as I miss her and as much as her presence will be missed, I rejoice.
Yes. Yes.
The worst thing that can happen to us isn't that bad. Really? Is it really that bad? What do we have to be afraid of?
Exactly.
The stuff is just the stuff. This world is a trial. So let it work. It's perfect work in us. Let the glory just come. Because of who we are, because it's not about us, it's about resting in him and revealing him.
Yes.
And when we trust him, when we choose him, when we look outside of ourselves and we focus on those around us that have a need, when we focus on the people around us, it's easier to pray for someone else than it is to pray for yourself.
Yeah.
It's always easier. So just be encouraged.
Yes.
And wait expectantly, wait peacefully, wait joyfully. And it will come to pass.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Just to add to that, I don't know, it just keeps popping into my head. I heard it, I don't know, in the last week or so, and I'm not sure where. But, you know, sometimes we worry because we're busy looking at ourselves, what kind of an influence or, you know,
mm-hmm.
that we're not feeling him, but we are light. Because he is in us.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard that
true. Oh. Anyone else have anything they want to share or testimony or prayer? Yeah.
Yeah, I've never, all these years, I had the Lord's blessing. I had a couple that I'm sure that she's had some anxiety trouble. And somehow, I had this ear trouble, and God led me to pray for her. And there I was, out in the midst. There's no manager there. Just in God's time. And I'm sitting there, I prayed for her. And I'm so honored that we have a Heavenly Father that we can really take hands for us to. I mean, I'm not scared, but I was losing half of my hearing and couldn't hear my symbol. And realized I had trouble with my ears. God opened the door to it, and it was my doctor. I could not believe this. Now I'm in your heart. This is what your symptoms are. Telling them what was going on in my ears and my nose. This is when they gave you that nose spray, James. No, listen, if that doesn't work, that lady worked with you, come back Friday. And it was like God was telling me. We'll get your ears cleared out. You won't be like that. I said, that should have been done in the first place when they looked at it. You know something, you're right. And I said, well, but I have an ear vacuum. My mom's over at Walmart and found an ear vacuum. So I made sure I have myself to see if it works. But all I can do is try. And God knows I can try. We still believe in him. We still succeed. And it puts us to a whole new level. And it puts us in him. He's the vessel. And he's like we're steering the ship. I've never put it this way. That we have to look forward to catch that new wave of new believers that are coming out here. And it's so deep for me to say that it's just so enlightening to God. And I was mowing Cheryl's yard, and it was like one day, yesterday, and I'm like, wait a minute, why is she so bitter? I missed an appointment at USO, you had a problem. She wouldn't let me go someplace, and it was kind of buried. But yet the Lord answered. I'm sitting there, James, come back here. I want to give you something. She gave me $10 for the work. I didn't expect that. We're only expecting God's miracles. And if we lead people to Jesus, how more firm of a foundation we have and how thankful we are to have vessels like Suzanne, Mike, and all these people that are prophesiers. I would say Jody, that was very big in the time, and Robert, his neat sense of humor, and he's been a blessing to all of us. We're all vessels, and he's the sailor, and we're steering the ship, and I can't see it more clearly. We just do both to catch that wave, to see where God's going to put us, and I can't sing that strong enough.
No.
But,
praise the Lord. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
All right. Anyone have any prayer requests? Or
I still do.
Oh, James, yeah?
My ears are
okay.
Still clogged. My sinus is open up here for days.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
There's a sister I met her. Who else but all of them that are connected?
Okay. Yeah, Mark. Did you have something?
I remember Paul Roper. Healing, new heart, literally. Keep lifted up my wife. Appreciate the prayer.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else? All right, well, let's stand and go to the Lord.
You know, I just want to say something that just come to my mind again. You know, sometimes people pop into our mind, and we might think, oh, what a coincidence, or I wonder what's going on. And I was mowing my yard, and for some reason, one of my coworkers popped into my mind about, it's like 2:30, 3 o'clock, something like that. And as I was mowing, what I'm thinking about while I'm mowing, I think, is just
come before you right now, Lord, and with your people. Ourselves in your word, Lord, and be about your business, Lord. To guide our steps, Lord. To put the people in our paths, Lord, that need your light, Lord, that need your encouragement, Lord. That when those thoughts come, Lord, that we lift up those people, Lord, in those moments, Lord, knowing that every thought, Lord, every need, Lord, that you will make known. Joni's family to you, Lord, the whole situation, Lord, that you would make a way where there seems to be no way, Lord. Peace, Lord, we speak peace and rest, Lord. Peace I give you, not as the world. He's given us his peace. Thank you, Lord, for the peace that passes understanding, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you keep us. You are our shield and our our strength and our exceedingly great reward. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, you are holy. Okay. Eastern Gate this Friday for anybody who can make it, 7 p.m., focusing on rest. Details about Joni's visitation and funeral will be this Saturday. The visitation is from noon to 2:30 at, I think it's at Hamilton's on Lyon Street, with the funeral immediately following the visitation. Sally has a list of refreshments. There will be a dinner for family at the church afterwards. And there's some of us that can't make it, so if you're able to help serve or to help clean up afterwards, please talk to Sally and make arrangements. Let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Lord. John, you want to come take the offering tonight, please?
Hallelujah. Come on, James. be lifted high. For your glory be lifted high. Be lifted high. Be lifted high. For your glory be lifted. Be lifted high. Be higher than any mountain and we can face, Lord. Thank you. hearts will love and adore.
That's evidence, you know, that wherever two or three are gathered, I mean, his presence isn't waiting on a big crowd. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Just when people will lift up the name of the Lord, when we praise him, hallelujah, he does manifest. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. And what we have to understand is in a manifestation like this, healing's here. Deliverance is here. Breakthrough's here. Whatever the need is, all you have to do is just reach out and take it by faith.
Hallelujah.
That's what he's offering us. His presence brings fullness of joy. Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. at his right hand.
Hmm.
Forevermore. Praise God. Praise God. But, I mean, it's just a shame if we leave a service like this without what we came for. And we came for his presence. But that's the idea. When we lift him up, when we praise him, he manifests his presence so that we can partake, so that we can... He's the healer. He is that. He became poor that we might become rich. All of that's available. All we do is just thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, kids, for worshiping. Amen. Thank you. Glory to God. Amen. God bless you for being here tonight. Praise the Lord. Look forward to seeing everybody and more Friday night. Amen. Come for whatever. I mean, honestly, we say this all the time, but if you can only come for 15 minutes, come for 15 minutes, 30 minutes. Just come and be part of what God's doing. Hallelujah. If you can stay for the whole 2 hours, great. But don't feel bad if you can only stay for a half hour of it or an hour. Just come and be part of what God's doing. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. I keep thinking about a story I read a long time ago about revival in, I think it was in Argentina. It was in South America anyway. And how it all started out with one guy and his wife and three other people. A backslid preacher, an unsaved house worker, domestic worker, and another elderly woman. And they went through service after service after service, just those three, nothing ever happening. They'd worship, they'd praise the Lord. And finally, if I remember right, the pastor said, look, just come up and touch the table while you're worshiping. Just come touch the table. And they all thought it was ridiculous. Oh, that's stupid. Why would we touch the table? And just do it, he said. Just do it. And the young lady, she said, oh, I just feel like an idiot. And finally, she yielded. Touched the table, and the Holy Spirit just fell on all of them. The backslid preacher's under the table speaking in tongues. The young woman is walking around praying in tongues. The old lady's praying in tongues. The pastor and his wife are speaking in tongues. I mean, just the Holy Spirit just fell. And that was the beginning of a nationwide revival.
That's right.
That totally swept that country.
That's right.
Now, you say, what are we going to do here? We've got more than they had. And we have people here filled with the Holy Ghost. You know? So... You know, I just don't buy this, you know, well, nothing's happening. Hey, they could have said the same thing. Nothing happened for a long time.
Right.
Something was happening. They just didn't see it happening. It was happening in the spirit. It has to happen there before it can happen here. And we live in a time and in a geographic location where there are greater powers of the enemy, you know, working against what God wants to manifest. And he has to do it through us.
Right.
When we get our eyes off of him, we start seeing all the other stuff,
right.
and it limits God.
Mm-hmm.
He's limited to what we're able to believe.
Right.
Yes.
And I believe for big-time revival.
Woo.
I mean revival. I'm talking about real revival, not just a rehashing of somebody else's experience. I'm talking about a genuine, this place, one time, first time, God revival.
Yes.
Amen. Woo. So, hallelujah. And everything that happens... happens for a purpose.
Yes.
Suzanne mentioned it a while back about when we first were having Wednesday night services because they were only having Sunday service. And we just basically picked out Ephesians. And I don't know why. It just, you know, we thought, well, it sounds good. But God had a reason for doing that. We think things happen by accident. We think it's just coincidence or we're just doing what we can do. But God has a plan, just like Tammy said. There are no coincidences. There are no accidents with Christians. Amen? They're not. If they started out to be, they won't be after they happen. Amen. So let's just, as Mike was saying and others have talked about, let's hunger after God. Let's pursue him.
and watch what he does. Amen. That's all there is to it. And it's not a labor. It's not a work. It's just, as Suzanne said, it's really resting in the pursuit. It's resting in the belief that he will show up because I'm me. Because I'm his son. I'm his child.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen? All right. Praise the Lord. Well, let's get right into this so we can get you out of here and home at a reasonable time in the middle of the week. Amen? I'd like to go to Galatians chapter 6, verses 14 through 16. You know, based on the things that Suzanne said in the preliminaries and the testimonies I've heard, I think we're right on with the Holy Spirit tonight. Praise the Lord. So here Paul is speaking to the church at Galatia, and he says, "But God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them, and mercy and upon the Israel of God." Now let me read it to you from the Message Bible, because it's really cool. "For my part, I'm going to boast about nothing but the cross of our Master, Jesus Christ. Because of that cross, I've been crucified in relation to the world, set free from the stifling atmosphere of pleasing others and fitting into the little patterns that they dictate. Can't you see the central issue in all this? It is not what you and I do, submit to circumcision, reject circumcision. It's what God is doing, and he's creating something totally new, a free life. All who walk by this standard are the true Israel of God, his chosen people. Peace and mercy upon them." Praise the Lord. So, have you ever been driving, just here a while back, I forget where we were, Sally and I were somewhere, and I turned down a road. Oh, I know what it was. We were looking for my daughter had bought a kid's Tupperware set. She'd had one when she was a little girl, and she was getting one for Izzy. And they don't have the Tupperware parties. You got to go to a distributor, and so there was a lady in Ankeny. And we were trying to find this place, and I thought I could cut through instead of taking the main street, because it was right at 5 o'clock, and traffic's getting as bad there as it is in Des Moines almost. So on my shortcut, I ended up on a dead-end street. Had to turn clear around, go back to the original route, and go back, and then we found it. So my question is just this. Have you ever been driving and come to a dead end?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. I know we've been on trips, and last time we went to Arizona several years ago, there was just nothing but road construction all across New Mexico, western Texas, just one mess after another, and your road was either closed and you had to take a detour, or you had to turn around and go back, or you had to stay on one lane. It was just a nightmare. But the bottom line is, no matter how aggravated you are, you got to pick another road.
Sure. Yeah.
Or the trip, or the journey, or the destination is not going to be reached. So dead ends are negative.
Yes.
And dead ends are inevitable in life.
Mm-hmm.
You ever had reached a place in your job where they said you're at the top of the pay scale, if you stay here another 30 years in this job position, there's no more raises. That's a dead end. Or even a job itself. It's just going nowhere. You know, I mean, you're just going through the motions, and it's a dead-end job. Amen?
Right.
How about relationship? You ever had a relationship? Oh, praise the Lord. Don't everybody raise your hand at once.
No.
But you reach a dead end.
Yeah.
But what if the dead end could actually be a lifesaver?
Yeah.
Right.
What if dead end was necessary in developing your relationship with God? See, man-made paths are always dead ends. They always end in failure. No matter how well-intended they are, no matter how hard we work at them, they always end up a dead end. But the path that God has created
includes two dead ends, at least, that I'm aware of. The first dead end happens so that you can enter a personal relationship with him.
Amen.
I remember in Houston, Texas, when I believe I had my a genuine encounter with God. I received the Holy Spirit and was baptized and stuff, sometime later, months later, almost a year later. But I reached the end of myself. Now, I had prayed the sinner's prayer many times, but that was the time and the place where I said, God, if you're not real, if you're not going to do something, I don't want to live anymore. I'm sick of this. I'm sick of being high and drunk and messed up one relationship after another and just, you know, everything. Just I was just fed up. And I can remember on the floor of that house in Houston on my face and just cussing God, screaming and hollering and ranting and raving. I was the only one there. Sally was back here in Iowa. And I can't say that I had an epiphany or that I saw God, but I just kind of wore myself out. I'd been drunk for days and high and everything else. And but the Lord directly, I can tell you, I'm not going to go through the whole testimony, but he literally directed my steps to a church where I got born again, where I got baptized, where I received the Holy Spirit. Church that I would have never gone to had I known. They didn't have a sign up yet because it was a brand new building. And all of the things that led up to that, the house that we rented and how the plumbing went, they were tearing up the street to redo the plumbing. We had to, couldn't take it. And I was tired driving back and forth from Houston to Beaumont before I could go out into my territory. So I finally did. I said, well, I'm renting something this weekend. I don't care. And as it turns out, it was three blocks away from the church that we would end up going to because I didn't want to be a hypocrite and wait till Christmas, so we went like Thanksgiving or something. But everything, I mean, the whole situation, it was comical because Vidor, Texas, which is just across the river from Beaumont, is a dry town. You got to go outside the city limits to buy liquor. I can remember driving around when we first rented this house, and I was driving around. I always had a cooler in the back, you know, with beer, and I was about out of beer, so I was going to stop and pick up some beer. I went to half a dozen quick, you know, little get-and-go things, and finally I thought, geez, where's the beer, you know? So I ended up going to the supermarket. They didn't have it either. I said, where does a person get a beer in this town? They said, you don't. You're kidding me. No. But if you drive out here north of town, you know, there's another little convenience store out there, and that was the closest one. There you could get wine and beer and stuff. But it was just ironic. It was like God saying, you know, I thought you had enough of this, you know? And so it just, one thing after another. But it took a place where all of us, when we got saved, and your situation could have been different than mine and probably was, but we all come to a place that's the end of us where we have to say, I'm sick of this, Lord. I've got to have something else.
Right.
And that's a dead end. But it's a dead end that we all have to experience in order to have this relationship with him. So the first dead end is self-trust. In order to move on, you've got to believe and confess, I can't do this. I can't handle this. Whatever it is, I'm not just talking about salvation, but that's the first step. But if you realize it, if you think about it, it happens over and over in our relationship with God.
Yeah.
Anybody ever watch Seinfeld? Well, he's on, reruns are on now. Every day, starting at 4:30. You should tune in sometime. Classic. Channel 247. That's DirecTV. And there's episode after episode until 6:30. So you can get caught up in a hurry. But they're hilarious. They're idiots, and they're just dysfunctional, antisocial, messed up. They're like us. Praise the Lord. Except they're not saved. But George Costanza is this loser, and he's always screwing up relationships. He wants to be in love, but then when he gets in love, he can't handle the commitment. Then he tries everything he can to get out of it. Then when he's out of it, he's wishing he was back in it. Then he gets back in it, and now he's messed up because he's back in it. It was on and on and on. But they had one episode, and it made me think about this. Maybe you've been through this before too, but you ever been in a relationship with somebody that ended, they ended the relationship by using the classic line, it's not you, it's me. I've heard that. I didn't believe it, but I mean, I knew it was me. But they're trying to be kind. They're just wanting out of it without a scene, you know, without a mess. And it's not you. It's me. I got the problem. It's not you. You're perfect. Anybody would want you. I don't know why I don't. It's me. It's me. But when we hit a dead end with God, we're faced to acknowledge just the opposite. It's not me. It's all about you.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. It's all about you, Lord. It's not about me. It's not about how good I am, how bad I am, how consistent I am, how inconsistent I am. It's about you, God. Mm-hmm. So I want to show you something from Exodus. Let's just look at a few scriptures here from Exodus chapter 14, Mike. We'll look at 9 through 16. And I know you're probably all familiar with this, but I just want to use this as kind of a way of expressing some of this. Exodus 14, 9 through 16. This is the Red Sea experience, right? So God has gotten them out of Israel, or out of Egypt, excuse me, gotten Israel out of Egypt, and he's trying to get them to the promised land. But the Egyptians pursued after them, all the horses and chariots of Pharaoh and his horsemen and his army overtook them, encamping by the sea beside Pihahiroth, between Baal Zephon. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid, and the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. So you've got this quasi-deliverance. Anybody ever had like a breakthrough only to find yourself in a worse mess or an unfulfilled promise?
Right.
Looking like the promise was fulfilled, and all of a sudden it's manifesting other stuff. So, on. And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Now, I can actually say, I paraphrased that talking to God before.
Yeah.
You know, wasn't my life a big enough mess before that you had to, you know, make me think that I had it all together and now I'm in this mess?
Yeah.
Well, I'm the only one that's ever felt that way, but... Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptian whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward. But lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. Well, my situation was not unlike theirs. As long as I was believing God, manifestation. The moment the manifestation didn't agree with what I had been praying, then I stop trusting God and start complaining.
Yeah.
And then wonder why the manifestation doesn't continue.
Yeah.
Right.
So what God does, obviously here, they weren't operating by faith. They had to have sight. But God uses Moses to encourage them or to give them a hope, as Suzanne was talking about. A hope that wasn't predicated on what they could see, but just a hope on what was being said.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I got you out of there. I can get you out of here. God's going to do this, right? So Israel had to accept that God was the only one who could deliver them. That was the point. Moses was not their deliverer. Moses was just the guy with the rod. Jesus, God, was the one who delivers. So they had to come to the end of their self-trust or their trust in what man was going to be able to do for them. So it was a dead end. I mean, this is a major dead end. But at the same time, what a powerful result. Because if it hadn't been for the dead end, they'd have still been trusting. They'd have been trying to swim across that thing or build boats or who knows what or given in to the Egyptian army. So let's look at Exodus 14, verses 27 through 31. I'm saying this, and I hope you understand, this is a positive message. But we reach dead ends. All of us do, in different areas. And the tendency is to want to throw up your hands and say, okay, take me back. You know, take me back to Egypt. Or just, you know, I don't want to fight this fight. I don't, it doesn't look like there's any way for me to win it. It doesn't look like there's any way. See, we've got to get to the place where we quit trusting in ourselves.
Right.
Quit looking at what we can do to fix it.
Right.
Or to make it happen.
Right.
That's the message of the Bible. Dead ends are to get us to turn to Him and quit trying to butt against the roadblock and just say, look, the only way out of here is with God. So Moses stretched forth his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to its strength when the morning appeared. And the Egyptians fled against it, and the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. The Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. And the waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen and all the hosts of Pharaoh that came into the sea after them. There remained not so much as one of them. But the children of Israel walked upon dry land in the midst of the sea. And the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore. And Israel saw that great work which the Lord did upon the Egyptians. And the people feared the Lord. Amen. And believed the Lord and his servant Moses. Praise God. So the Red Sea wasn't representative of only the end of their self-trust. It was a dead end that brought them to the end of trusting in what they could do. But that isn't all that it was. It also represented the beginning of their freedom. They didn't have to worry about enemies catching them anymore. Because the enemies were floating in the Dead Sea. The Red Sea. Just a slip of the tongue there. Pardon the pun. It was the Dead Sea for the Egyptians, praise the Lord. So they didn't have to worry about the enemy anymore. Now they could focus on the relationship that God was providing for them.
Amen.
All right, Exodus 15, verses 1 and 2. God brings us to dead ends to turn us to focus on Him. Because it's the only way that He can provide for us. The only way He can manifest and do the things that He wants to do is when the focus is on Him and not on us and the situation. So then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for He hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath He thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song. He is become my salvation. He is my God, and I will prepare Him a habitation. My Father's God. And I will exalt Him.
Yes.
Praise. That's the result of a dead end.
Yep. Yep.
Praise God.
Yep.
The Promised Land, you know, it was a real place.
Yep.
But it also is an analogy of freedom. The freedom that God wants all of us to experience.
Yes.
All of us should be enjoying our Promised Land. That Promised Land is the true relationship with Jesus. Life, joy, provision for whatever the need is. And to enter the Promised Land and experience real relationship with God, we have to come to the end of self-trust. That's all there is to it. We've experienced portions of the Promised Land. But then we draw back. Fear. Stress. Relationship. Circumstances, situations. We don't realize it's just another dead end trying to get us to turn back and trust in His provision. Rest, the theme for Friday night. It's what it's all about. It's just coming into His rest. If we hang on to the belief that we can somehow earn our way or fix things ourselves or change circumstances or people or situations, it's a dead end.
Mm-hmm.
And it's self-trust.
Yes.
Now, let's look at a few scriptures here. I'm just going to look at these quickly, but Leviticus chapter 4, verse 1. We could go through this, but I just want you to see some of the things that Israel was dealing with. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, That isn't it. Leviticus 4 and 1. There we go. Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, I'm sorry, I should have said that. Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, if a soul shall sin through ignorance against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning things which ought not to be done and shall do against any of them, blah, 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 blah. So here's a sin of ignorance. We would all be guilty of that. I would certainly be guilty of an ignorant sin. I have been guilty of ignorant sins. I've been ignorant and sinned. Praise the Lord. Okay, now let's look at 5, 1 and 2, I think, as well. If a soul sin and hear the voice of swearing as his witness, whether he hath seen or known of it, if he do not utter it, then he shall bear his iniquity. Or if a soul touch an unclean thing, whether it be a carcass of an unclean beast or a carcass of an unclean cattle or the carcass of an unclean creeping thing, and it be hidden from him, he also shall be unclean and guilty. All right, 6 and 2. Chapter 6, verse 2. If a soul sin and commit a trespass against the Lord and lie unto his neighbor in that which was delivered him to keep, or in fellowship, or in a thing taken away by violence, or hath deceived his neighbor, or hath found that which was lost, and lieth concerning it, and sweareth falsely in any of all these, that man doeth sinning therein. Now, it just goes on and on and on, and it's almost like I get this picture. You know, because we know now what this is all about, but it's almost like the angels are getting a kick out of this, and they're saying, here, try this one. Here, give them this one. Let's see what they do with this. You know, God's laying it all out, and they're all up there just, you know, let's try it. Throw that out there and see what they do with it. This is going to be great. You know, it just goes on. It's incredible. Just the numbers of things. I mean, things that you can't even imagine. And even though you don't imagine him, you can still be guilty. So God has shown us a way to be made right with him without keeping the requirements of the law. It's by faith in Jesus Christ.
Yes.
All right, look at Romans chapter 3, verses 21 through 27. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past, through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just, and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. Where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? Nay, but by the law of faith.
Yes.
So the other dead end, we had the one of self-trust. The other dead end is brokenness. Brokenness is giving up on your own confidence and ability to manage life.
Yes.
Anybody get broken? Life is just unfixable. Life cannot be you cannot manage life because other people are involved. And at some point, you'll kill yourself. Or you'll drive yourself mad, or you'll kill somebody else, or you'll burn out if you don't recognize that that brokenness is from God. It's God saying, you can't do this. You were never meant to be able to do this. The brokenness turns you to him. Say, God, you've got to do this. I can't get it fixed. I can't make it happen. I can't change them. I can't change the circumstance. I can't change the situation.
Right.
Anybody been broken before? I mean, I in the old church over there, I can remember laying there crying and weeping and sobbing and praying in tongues. And a lot of that was as much out of frustration as it was spirituality. But I was broken. And it caused me to come to a place where sometimes other people may think he just doesn't care. It isn't that I don't care. It's just that I've already been down this road enough times to know I can't make it happen.
Right. Right.
I'm depending on God.
Amen.
It isn't that I don't care. It isn't that I'm indifferent. It's that I know there's only one way this can happen.
Yes.
Right.
And I'm not gonna beat people up, threaten, intimidate, coerce, cajole.
Right.
I'm just not going to do it. That's not what God called me for.
Right.
I'm going to point him to Jesus.
Amen.
I've been broken. I've been there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trusting him.
Amen.
Amen. So, praise the Lord. When you get to that place, you're going to realize that you can't do it on your own. That's when you find the faith in the one who can. You start looking to him, and all of a sudden he starts giving you reasons to believe him. 1 Thessalonians 5. Let's go to somewhere in the middle. Chapter 5, verse, 8 or something. I don't know. I want to go down through 22. The first part's kind of, I mean, it's all good, but I don't want to take too much time in it. That's good. Let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet the hope of salvation. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Wherefore, comfort yourselves together and edify one another, even as also you do. Okay, there's one right there. Comfort one another, edify one another, okay? Okay, most of us, we can do that. Who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Wherefore, comfort yourselves together and edify one another, even as also ye do. Again, most of us we qualify there. We try to encourage one another and comfort one another and so forth, okay? We beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Kind of rises and falls with the circumstances and situations, right? But most of us, we'd make it. We can handle that, okay? Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly. Comfort the feeble-minded. Support the weak. Be patient toward all men. That's not easy sometimes. Sometimes it's hard to be patient with, you know what I'm saying? You just go, whoa, let's move on. Praise the Lord. Back up again, please, Mike. See that none render evil for evil unto any man. That's hard not to do. It's hard not to retaliate in kind. It's hard not to, somebody says something stupid, you say something stupid. Amen? But, you know, maybe we can do it. Patient towards all men. Let me back up for a minute. Man, you may have lost me right there. I handle the feeble-minded, support the weak, but patient towards everybody. Some people, you know, you think they don't deserve patience. They need to just be slapped upside the head. They need to wake up. They need to come on. I love you and the Lord, and I'm going to give you the right fist of fellowship. Praise the Lord. But see that none render evil for evil unto any man. Yeah, well, but ever follow that which is good. Now, getting close to my toes. Both among yourselves. Okay, we might do that, but to all men, even the ones that aren't good, they don't deserve to be good too, but that's what he tells us. Rejoice evermore. Anybody ever had a problem with that? Sometimes you just don't feel like rejoicing. It just isn't like, this is not a rejoicing moment. Huh? Pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks. Thank you, sir, I'll have another. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the Spirit. Despise not prophesying. I won't as long as it's for me. Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. Abstain from all appearance of evil. Oh, man. I'd have to be invisible. Do you see how difficult this looks like? Leviticus. And if we read it with this self-performance or this, I'm going to be able to fix it all, you know, with in other words, it's another dead end. Praise God. That's all the things we're supposed to do. But then comes verse 23. And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless under the coming of the Lord. On to verse 24. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. He will do it. He will do it. He brings us to the end of ourselves so that he can do it.
Amen.
That's the rest. This is the rest that we're talking about. Yes. Acts chapter 17, verse 28. In him we live and move and have our being, right?
Yes.
For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said before, we are also his offspring. Yes. All of life is in him. But you only experience it when you give it all up to him.
Amen.
We all come to dead ends. We all come to this place of brokenness. And it's God help me. I mean, it's like we've done everything we can do. Let's pray.
Yeah.
I mean, that's
exactly
what we do.
Yeah.
Or, you know, you know, without saying it, we've wore ourselves out.
Uh-huh.
We're bitter. We're angry with people. We're frustrated with people. We're aggravated about situations and circumstances. It's a dead end. And all God is asking is for you to say, help me. God, help me. And that's all he's asking. And the result is Romans 5, verse 16. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. So even though we're guilty, the gift leads to made right. The reason for the made right with God is for the relationship, so that we have access to those provisions. You see, the dead ends of self-trust, the dead end of brokenness, all things do work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. So don't get angry with the dead end. Drop the load in his lap.
Amen.
Cast all your care upon him,
amen,
for he cares for you. Dead ends,
yes,
are for us.
Yeah.
Not that he wants us on a dead end, but there's only one path to him. And if you get off that path, you're going to be on a dead end. If you get off the path of God's provision, of God's grace, of God's rest, you end up in dead ends. And the reason for the dead end is to get you back rest, back to grace, back to God's provision. He can do all things through them who trust him. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. So if you find yourself in a dead end, say, praise the Lord. Help me, Jesus. And put it back in his hands. And if you aren't, you will. Because as was so rightly said here tonight, we live in a world full of dead ends, full of dead-end people, full of broken people, full of people that are looking for the path. And the path is not us, the path is Him. And they need to see us at peace. They need to see us at rest. They need to see us confident in this God. Not in ourselves, not in our abilities, not in our, you know, Christianese kind of codex that we, the codes that we use, you know, words and so on and so forth. They just need to know a real God from real people that are experiencing Him. Amen. God wants you blessed. He wants you in the promised land, or He wouldn't have brought you out of Egypt.
Right.
But you're going to have the Red Seas. But the Red Seas are to bring you into a fuller relationship with Him. So you're not constantly looking over your shoulder at the next bad thing that's going to happen or the next spear that's going to be thrown at you by the enemy. You know what I mean? You had some bad experiences. It causes you to start, you know, you ever seen a dog that's been smacked around and beat, and every time you go up to pet, the thing ducks or pees on your leg or something, you know, because he's expecting to get hit again. Yeah. Well, that's the way we get sometimes when we're going through crap, and when it's a dead end, when it's God trying to get us to turn to Him, we're so busy looking around at the negative stuff that's going on that we forget the only way out of it is to look to Him, is to put it back on Him, trust Him. Quit looking at the thing. Quit trying to fix the thing. It's not yours to fix.
Amen.
We can't even fix ourselves. How do we think we're going to fix somebody else? We just need to get them to God. We just need to put ourselves in that place where we're trusting Him. I think Suzanne said it tonight. When we get to the place where we really begin to rest in Him, then what's manifesting is not that big a deal. Because we're not looking for manifestation to prove to us that God's going to do something. We just trust God, and the manifestation will happen by itself.
Yep.
Amen.
Amen.
It's like a microcosm of revival. God comes and brings revival, and then we think we're going to do a better job of it.
Yeah.
And it ends up being a dead end,
right.
A chaotic mess, because it happened simply because of Him. And everybody says, well, you know, we got to get prayed up. We got to get prayed through. We got to get everybody cleaned up and acting right and doing all. Then if that's what it takes for revival, there'd never be a revival.
Exactly.
Never.
Exactly.
Revival comes in the middle of chaos and sin and brokenness and stupidity and dead ends and all of these things where people just finally just turn back to God. They're not, it isn't like, okay, we've all repented and got our act together. Repentance is just looking back to God. It's changing the direction that you're focused on. It's not all of a sudden I'm being perfect and so now God's going to come. What's He going to do for me now? I'm perfect. The repentance that they talk about before revival is people changing their focus from church, from religion, from their behavior, from their action, and just looking to God.
Yes.
Trusting that God's going to come and do something.
Yes.
Believe me, God wants revival more than any of us can imagine.
Amen.
He wants to come in here and do a work that will astound people if the Lord tarries for another 100 years.
Yes, exactly.
Because it brings Him glory. It lights up God, not us.
Amen.
Let's look to Him. If we're going to hunger and thirst for righteousness, He is our righteousness. Let's just look for Him.
Amen.
Let's just, here we are, Lord. We've reached a dead end. I'm in a place of brokenness. I can't fix this. I can't, my relationship, my financial situation, this, whatever it is. It's yours, Lord.
Amen.
See. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
God bless you. You're dismissed. Hope to see you all here Friday evening.